More Than You Can Say by Paul Torday. Read by Jonathan Keeble. Chapter 1. I had been living on the edge for the last couple of weeks. If I were truthful, maybe for the last couple of years. Maybe ever since I'd left the army. I'd started looking over my shoulder again, mostly at things that weren't there. Camilla, my girlfriend at the time, used to say I had paranoid tendencies. I used to reply that if she'd been where I'd been, she'd be paranoid too. It was a small thing, but it irritated her. Then, at a party, we had a falling out. It was one of those arguments like a summer thunderstorm. Violent, but not serious. At least, I hadn't thought it was at first. I can't remember what the particular row was about. We were always having them. Anyway, I walked out of wherever we were at the time, a party somewhere in Kensington, and went to a pub and had a drink. Then I had another drink. It turned out it was serious, after all, the row with Camilla, I mean. Apparently, I'd said I would marry her. I can't remember exactly when I'd proposed or whether she had said yes. I'll think about it was more her style. But after I left her, she rang me on my mobile several times. Eventually, this must have been after my third or fourth drink, I decided to throw my mobile phone into a bin. Then I decided that was a bad idea, because someone might find it and run up an enormous bill that I would have to pay. So I walked all the way to the embankment and threw it into the river. No more calls, no more Camilla. Luckily, I don't have the kind of job where you have to show up in the office every morning at 8 o'clock. If I did, I would have been fired. I didn't turn up anywhere much before noon for the next fortnight. I drank too much, talked too much when I could find someone to talk to, stayed up too late, and then woke in the middle of the morning feeling hungover and sweating. Sometimes I was still wearing the clothes I'd put on the previous morning. Then I'd have a shower, tidy myself up a bit, but not too much, and go and have an enormous breakfast in the Greek cafe on the corner of my street in Camden. Sometimes I would try to take some exercise, go for a walk in Regent's Park or to the gym. But exercise for its own sake bores me, so if I didn't have any jobs to do for my employer, I usually gave up, went back to the flat and opened a bottle of wine, then read the papers until the sky darkened, the streetlights came on, and it was time to go out. Where I went to depended on my frame of mind. Sometimes I went to the cinema. Occasionally I would call up a friend from the diminishing list of those who would still speak to me and try to persuade him or her, usually him, most of the hers had put a line through my name in their address book, to go out for a drink or a cheap supper somewhere. In recent weeks, the only invitation I'd received was a gold-edged card inviting me to attend a reception at Lancaster House for veterans of the Afghan campaign. I don't know why I didn't throw it out. I don't like those sort of occasions, on the whole. But I suppose it was thought that I might meet one or two people I had once known. In the end, I wrote and said I would come. Maybe it would make me feel better to talk to someone else who knew what it had been like. If I had nowhere else to go, I would go to the Diplomatic, a private members' club. Why it chose that particular name, I do not know, as diplomacy was not an obvious quality of most of the membership, either professionally or personally. If there was any common ground shared by the members, apart from a love of card games, backgammon and roulette, it would be hard to say what it was. We had a German graf, an English marquis, an East End property dealer, and a Turkish Cypriot drug dealer on our list. We even had a few bankers who lubricated the club with real cash. Most of us preferred to rely on markers and IOUs in various forms. The stakes were never enormous, but all the same, if you played there regularly, it was quite easy to lose serious amounts of money. Well, that was one reason why I hadn't been near the club for the last few weeks. I owed quite a lot of money. Several members were carrying my markers for a few hundred pounds each, and it was becoming embarrassing. But that's the way cards run. I hadn't held a decent hand for weeks. We played poker, mostly, and believe me, you can be a great player, which I am not, but you still need to hold a few good cards if you want to win. The night on which my biographer, if I ever have one, will say I finally lost the plot, I was flush with cash for once. I'd done a couple of jobs, and to my surprise, my employer had paid me not only for those, but also the considerable amount he owed me in arrears. That was the good news. The bad news was that he fired me. What he actually said was, "I think you need to take a nice long holiday. I'll call you sometime." I said, "Don't you like the way I work? I thought that was why you hired me." My employer, my former employer, said, "You are showing just a little too much enthusiasm. You might need more balance in your life. I don't know. I'll be in touch." I'd been fired from all sorts of jobs before, for all sorts of reasons, but being fired for being too keen on my work was a first. Anyway, to get to the point, I had over £2,000 in cash on me when I went into the diplomatic that night. If you don't already know the diplomatic, I wouldn't recommend you go out of your way to find it. It is down one of those little alleys that still exist in the one or two obscure mews of Mayfair, which have not yet been bulldozed to make way for a new office building or a block of service flats for rich non-doms. There's a front door, with no nameplate to indicate what lies behind it, a single lamp burning above it, and a small CCTV camera reminiscent of the entrance to a brothel. Once inside, the rich aroma of cigar smoke, the diplomatic has not yet caught up with the anti-smoking laws, and the sour smell of stale alcohol immediately dispel this impression. In the tiny hall is a large man squeezed behind a pretty leather-topped desk. This is Eric, the hall porter. Eric checks your name against a list to see whether you are a member or an invited guest. His orders are to make sure no one is admitted who is not on the list, nor anyone who is not wearing evening dress. So I had put on all the kit. Part of Eric's charm is that no matter how often he meets you, he will always forget your face, or at least pretend to. If you can get past Eric, and not everybody does, you enter a larger, dimly lit room, which is a bar. You can get almost anything you have ever heard of to drink there. And if you want to eat, then you can order from the list of bar snacks. I wouldn't recommend the food. But if you want to try a new brand of tequila, or you'd like a glass of salon champagne, or if you want to drink one of the best dry martinis or whiskey sours you can get in London, then Marco, the barman, will fix you up. Marco's dry martinis give your brain a jolt like an electric shock. I ordered one and sipped the chilly liquid for a second, waiting until the room reoriented itself around me. Then, feeling much better, I took my drink and myself upstairs. Upstairs there is a large gaming room. There are also a couple of smaller rooms where private games for very high stakes are played. I don't go into those. You wouldn't either, unless you happen to be a Russian oligarch or a Saudi prince. My gang was sitting around a card table playing a variant of poker called Texas Hold'em. This particular version doesn't seem to have any rules, with nearly every other card a wild card. I watched for a bit. At the table was Bernie, a heavyset man who owned a lot of rented flats in northeast London, Willy Falkenstein, whose wide estates in southern Bavaria had mostly been mortgaged to pay for his gambling habit, Ed Hartlepool, a man of about my own age, who spent most of his time in France to avoid paying too much income tax, and then came to London for a couple of days each month in order to lose all the income he had saved. Then there was the Mark. I didn't, of course, know the Mark. He was Bernie's guest, so he would be rich and probably stupid. Usually, one or other of us would try to bring someone like the Mark in order to give the game a fresh injection of cash. He was clearly in awe at being seated at the same table as a German nobleman, which was Willy, and an English one, which was Ed. And I felt sure that when he wrote the enormous check at the end of the evening to cover his losses, he would feel a deep sense of gratitude for having been allowed to play with such eminent people. Ed looked up and saw me. "Well, well, look who's here. It's the leader of the pack." They had always called me that, after the old song by the Shangri-Las, rather than my proper name, which is Richard. I'd been given my nickname because I nearly wrote myself off riding a Ducati around Hyde Park Corner at 100 miles an hour, which I had done at about 3 o'clock one morning after a jolly evening at the Diplomatic. It was for a bet. Everyone turned to look at me except the Mark, who blushed and kept his head down, not wanting to appear too familiar with his new friends. Bernie said, "Richard, you don't know Gussie here. Say hello to Richard Gussie." The Mark gulped and said something. It turned out he wanted to have the pleasure of buying me a drink, so I asked for another dry martini. "Join us," suggested Ed. "But we're playing with cash tonight, leader. No markers." "Well, I have some cash," I said carelessly. The £2,000 was most of the ready I had at that moment, and might have to last me God knew how long. I needed at least half of it for rent. For all I knew, I might be out on the street within a week if my landlord's patience finally snapped. I was unemployable, or as good as. My parents were unlikely to give me anything. I was broke, close to being homeless, practically destitute. But when had I ever worried about that sort of thing? I wasn't going to start now. "I might sit in for a couple of hands, if you don't mind me cutting in and then cutting out." "The pleasure will be all ours, dear boy," said Ed. He enjoyed needling me, but was careful never to push his luck. I patted Ed on the back in what I hoped was a patronizing way and pulled up a chair. A waiter handed me my second dry martini. I caught the Mark's gaze and raised my glass to him. He blushed again. The first hand was the best I'd been dealt for months. My two hole cards were a pair of kings. Next came the flop, three cards dealt face up. One of them was another king. Then I was dealt a two and a seven. I was up against Ed, who had a pair of sixes showing, and I suspected he had a third in his hole cards. He bet hard. I knew he thought I was bluffing when I stayed in and then raised him. At last came the river, the final card that is dealt face down. Mine was another seven, so now I had three of a kind and a pair. I let Ed try to buy the pot, then I called him. What a joy it was to see his expression when I turned over my hole cards to show him my hand. Half an hour later, I was £1,000 up. By two in the morning, I had won £10,000. It was the first time in God knows how long I'd been dealt such good hands. My run of bad luck had gone on for so long, no one else at the table, apart from the Mark who hadn't a clue, could bring themselves to believe I held good cards. Time and time again they called my bluff, only to find out that I wasn't bluffing. I didn't need to. It was wonderful. But all the same, something inside me kept saying, "Quit while you're ahead." Apart from the Mark, the other big loser that evening was Ed Hartlepool, and it was beginning to irritate him. He held about £1,000 worth of markers from me, and I had made him tear those up. Now he owed me £3,000 in cash. The temptation to go on and see whether I could seriously damage Ed's bank balance was strong. But just after two in the morning, I yawned loudly and said, "Well, I think I'm for my bed. Thank you all very much indeed. Is it okay if we settle up now?" There was general agreement that the game had gone on long enough, and besides, the Mark was beginning to show signs of real pain. His losses for the night must have been over £8,000. There was a general reckoning up, at the end of which the Mark handed me a check of just over £5,000. Ed took out his checkbook, which of course wasn't Barclays or Lloyd's or anything like that, but bore the name of some French-sounding private bank. He wrote out the check, not looking very happy, then held it up out of my reach. "Tell you what, leader, do you want to double your money?"
"Double or quits?"
"Of course, double or quits. I'm having lunch at the Randolph Hotel in Oxford tomorrow with my uncle. If you can join us by 1 o'clock sharp, I'll tear up this check and write you another for £6,000. And if you don't turn up, or turn up at 1 minute past, I'll just tear up this check." I thought about this for a moment. It didn't make sense. "What's the catch?"
"The catch is," said Ed, grinning at me, "that you have to walk there, starting from here, and arrive on time. And you have to produce evidence that you walked all the way."
There was some discussion around the table about what sort of proof I might have to provide. Road signs collected along the way was one bright suggestion. I ignored my companions and sat and thought about it. Bets of this sort were not uncommon at the diplomatic. Oxford was about 50 miles from central London, and it was now nearly 2:30 in the morning. That meant I would have to do 4.5, nearer 5 miles an hour. I'm a strong walker, and I knew I could probably do it. I lifted my head and stared at Ed for a moment, then said, "Bugger evidence. I'll do it, and you have my word that I won't cheat. I'll start now, and if you want to, you can get in your car and follow me. Otherwise, you'll just have to take my word for it. Anyway, it should be fairly obvious when you see me in the dining room at the Randolph whether I've been walking or not." Ed looked at me. Then he held out his hand.
"Your word?"
"All right. That's good enough for me."
It was all very old-fashioned.
We shook hands. Willy Falkenstein clapped me on the back and made an unfunny joke about mad dogs and Englishmen. I said, "I suppose I better get going now." A small cheer went up as I headed down the stairs. I heard Ed say, "Well, that's the quickest I've ever won £3,000 back." And Bernie saying in reply, "You ain't won your money back yet, Eddie. He's a mad sod. He might surprise you." I nodded goodnight to Eric the porter, who ignored me, and left the club. It was raining, but not hard. I set off at a brisk walk in a westerly direction. I have walked in some difficult places in both violent heat and bitter cold. For the first few miles, this walk was, by comparison, a piece of cake. The gentle drizzle soaked through the back of my evening jacket, and my black loafers were becoming rather damp. Although they were quite sturdy, I wondered whether they'd make the distance. I wondered whether I could walk fast enough to collect my £6,000. My biggest worry was being stopped by an inquisitive policeman. I was already attracting some odd glances as I strode rapidly along in my evening clothes. I walked up Park Lane, then at Marble Arch I turned into the Bayswater Road and pounded along until I reached Notting Hill Gate. From there, I thought I'd head west through Shepherd's Bush and up the Uxbridge Road towards the A40. My plan was to try to find roads that ran parallel to the main roads and motorways, where I would risk being picked up by a passing police car. My other concern was that I might be run over. Walking along a road in the middle of the night wearing black clothes wasn't exactly safe, although it would be light by the time I got out of the city. Somewhere near Shepherd's Bush, I found a big all-night supermarket and managed to buy a road atlas and a couple of cans of Red Bull. I swallowed the first of these as I walked, studying the map as best I could under the orange streetlights. A gentleman of the road joined me, a tall, bearded man wearing a long, navy blue coat fastened with bailer twine, and boots stuffed with old newspaper.
"I'm going your way,"
he said, exhaling aromatically over me.
"Let's walk together. I'll tell you the story of my life, then you can buy me breakfast. I know a nice little calf not far from here."
I reached into my coat pocket and peeled a note from the large wedge of cash inside. I had a quick look. It was a tenner. I waved it in front of my new companion, then let go, and it fluttered away in the breeze. He went after it, and I increased my pace. I saw no more of him. As the sky began to lighten, I found myself on a road bridge above the M25, approaching Gerrard's Cross. I looked at my watch. It was just 6:00 in the morning. I was beginning to feel quite footsore, and I wondered once again how long my shoes would hold out. For the first time, I began to doubt whether I would get to Oxford at all, let alone in the next 7 hours. It crossed my mind to go into the next town and find a taxi rank, but I suppressed the thought. In my place, I felt sure Ed Hartlepool would have taken the taxi. I walked on through Gerrard's Cross and along a B road that ran parallel to the A40. I was in the zone now, the way it used to be, my feet pounding the pavement in an endless beat. By now, I felt I could go on forever. The flayed feeling on the soles of my feet belonged to a different person in a different world. My whole body was covered in a thin film of perspiration. The volume of traffic had been steadily increasing and was now a constant roar in both directions. I was becoming increasingly aware of the closeness of trucks thundering past and cars racing towards me. Occasionally, someone would sound his horn as a sign of encouragement or derision. I wasn't sure which. Daylight had crept up on me in the last hour or two without me noticing it. My watch said 8:20. I was only just going to make it, as long as I did not slacken my pace. From somewhere, a smell of bacon drifted on the air, and for a moment I was overwhelmed by the desire to find a cafe and have an enormous breakfast, a breakfast that would cost me £6,000 if I stopped to take it. I kept walking. Somewhere between Stoke-on-Church and Wheatley, following a minor road that avoided the heavy traffic, I heard a car behind me and automatically moved closer to the grass verge so that it could pass. It was a bright, clear September morning, and I was no longer concerned about being knocked over. All the same, I didn't want to take any chances and looked over my shoulder to see where the car was. A black Range Rover was idling along some 25 yards behind me. I turned my head to the front again and kept walking. The road ahead was empty. There was a brief purr as the car accelerated. The next thing I knew, it was right alongside me, crowding me into the edge so that I almost stumbled on the grass verge. I shook my head in irritation and again waited for it to pass me. It didn't. It had tinted windows through which only the dimmest outline of its occupants could be seen. Then, the near side front window opened and the driver leaned across the passenger seat.
"Want a lift, old man?"
he asked. The speaker had a pale, narrow face and pale, curly hair. Enormous wraparound sunglasses obscured most of his features. "No, thanks."
"Good party last night, was it?"
I did not reply, waiting for him to lose interest and drive on.
"Where are you headed?"
This idiot was beginning to annoy me. I could not hold a conversation with him and continue walking at nearly 6 miles an hour. If I walked any more slowly, I'd lose my bet.
"Are you lost, old man? Don't know where you're going? Get in and we'll give you some breakfast and then set you on your way."
I managed to find enough breath to answer him.
"Would you very kindly fuck off?" "Oh, if you'd like us to fuck off, then of course that's what we'll do."
The window of the Range Rover wound up again, and then, instead of overtaking, the car pulled into the verge behind me. I resisted the strong temptation to look over my shoulder again and see what the driver was doing. I could hear the motor running. Half a mile ahead of me was a straggy line of houses marking a small village. Suddenly it seemed important to me to get to that village, where there were other people around and away from the Range Rover. I tried to speed up a little. Behind me I heard the snarl of the engine as the driver gunned it. I thought, thank God, he's going, whoever he is. There was something about the narrow face of the driver with its enormous aviator sunglasses that had made me feel uneasy. Suddenly, I felt a huge blow to my right side. I was pitched forward into the ditch at the side of the road and my head struck something hard. I was stunned and winded, and in so much pain I thought I was going to black out. Then I heard, through the mist of concussion, two car doors being slammed. The next second, two sets of hands were lifting me, and I was dragged around to the rear of the car, blinking and semi-conscious. The tailgate was opened, and then one pair of hands transferred itself to my ankles. With a grunt, the two men lifted me up to the height of the tailgate. They must have been strong, because I am not a small man, at 13 stone and 6'2", but they managed it. I was rolled onto the tailgate and then folded up so that I fitted into the rear compartment of the car. Then the tailgate was slammed shut and I was left in complete darkness, the parcel shelf pressing down on me. The car drove off and I screamed as we went around a corner and I was flung against the side of the car. I remember thinking that I should have looked over my shoulder after all. Then I might have seen them coming.
Chapter 2. I don't know how long I lay squashed up in the back of the car. Waves of nausea swept over me, accompanied by stabbing pains in my right side. On top of that, I started to get violent cramps in my legs because I could not straighten them. Luckily, I was not fully conscious. I kept fading in and out. The blow to my head must have given me concussion. After what seemed like a long time, I sensed the car was slowing down and then heard the scrunch of wheels on gravel. The car stopped, and a moment later the tailgate opened.
Somebody yanked me by the legs and I fell out of the car, winding myself again, as well as getting a nice bit of gravel rash on one side of my face.
"You're not going to cause any trouble, are you, old man?"
asked Narrowface. Another voice said, "Trouble? I don't think so. Look at him." I couldn't see the speaker, but I didn't much care what he was saying, because at that point I was sick. I managed to move my head so that I didn't spatter myself and tried to straighten my legs out. They were still screaming with cramp.
"Who's going to clear that up, I'd like to know?"
said Narrowface. "You are," said the other man unsympathetically. "But first let's get our guest into the house."
Our guest? Had I inadvertently won a dream holiday for one at a country house hotel?
The two men picked me up, hooking my arms around their shoulders as they half-carried, half-dragged me inside. I did not take in much of my surroundings, but was aware of a building in grey stone surrounded by lawns and woods. We were at the rear of a large house. Inside, I was dragged along a dark corridor, and then up a steep staircase and into another corridor, which was better lit and warmer than the first. We stopped outside a door while one of my new friends unlocked it. I was taken in and dropped onto a bed. After that, I don't remember much. I think I slept for a while. I was woken up by someone asking me my name. I know the answer to that one, I thought. Aloud, I said, "Richard Gaunt." "And your date of birth?" That was a bit harder. 3rd November 1975, I told the questioner, after a moment. I managed to open my eyes. The speaker was not one of the two men who had brought me here. He was short, dark-skinned, had black hair turning grey, and wore a dark blue suit. He leaned over me and shone a torch into my eyes. The stethoscope around his neck was a clue.
"You are awake. Good afternoon," he said. "I am Dr. Ahmed. I want to do some checking up on you, if you don't mind."
Good afternoon? Suddenly, memory flooded back. I had been walking. Walking to Oxford for a bet. A £6,000 bet. If it was the afternoon, then I had lost the bet. And the £6,000. I swore.
"Please, cooperate," said Dr. Ahmed anxiously. "It is for your own good."
"Don't worry, doctor," I said. "Only I've just remembered I'm late for an appointment."
"Ah, you must rest first and get better. Then we will see."
He set to work. First of all, he produced some cotton wool and alcohol from a black bag he had put down on a chair and cleaned up the grazes on my face. Then he helped me to unbutton my shirt and inspected the damage to my right side, where the Range Rover must have struck me. He applied some ointment, then prodded and poked me, not unsympathetically, until I winced.
"Unfortunately, you may have cracked a rib. I have not the facilities here for an ultrasound scan, but we can be confident it is not broken. You should not exert yourself for a few days. You will have some nasty-looking bruises for a while, but you should heal up as time goes by."
He checked my heartbeat, took my blood pressure and temperature, and looked again in my eyes and ears with his torch. Then he said,
"Also, you have the remains of some mild concussion. Take two of these paracetamol and we will see how you get on. Otherwise, there is not much wrong with you. You are a very fit man."
He poured me a glass of water to wash down the tablets, then packed his bag and left the room. I heard the key turn in the lock as he closed the door behind him. I sat up on the bed and looked around me. The room was small but comfortable and expensively furnished. It was full of those grace notes beloved by interior decorators, blue velvet curtains with yellow silk tie-backs, and a fringed and swagged blue velvet pelmet with yellow tassels, a pair of boudoir armchairs opposite a fireplace with an antique fire screen in front of it, a chair and a writing table by the window. The walls were covered in a blue and cream striped paper, and numerous prints and engravings of flowers hung from the picture rail. The bed I lay on was soft, and the room was warm. After a while, I swung my legs off the bed and made a careful effort to get to my feet. It hurt, but not as much as I had feared. I went to the window and looked out at a view that consisted mostly of a large blue Atlantic cedar, which someone had planted too close to the side of the house. Beyond it, I could make out wide, freshly mown lawns and a fringe of woodland. I had no idea where I was. Turning around, I noticed another door half open that led into a bathroom. Inside, fluffy white towels hung on a heated towel rail, and a wicker basket contained everything the forgetful guest might need, such as a toothbrush and razor. With some discomfort, I stripped off my clothes and stepped into the shower. I experienced the glorious relief of needles of hot water massaging my shoulders and back, relieving some of the pain. Once I'd shaved, cleaned my teeth, dried myself, and dressed again, I felt a great deal better, relatively speaking. It was then that I noticed various things were missing. My shoes were nowhere to be seen. Looking around, I realized that my evening jacket was not in the room. Neither was my wallet, nor the envelope I had taken from the diplomatic with all the cash and checks from my evening's winnings. I couldn't remember how much money I'd had, but it was several thousand pounds one way or another. My watch, an old Rolex my father had given me, was also gone. It had been an expensive day so far. I padded across the room to the door that led to the corridor and tried the handle. I hadn't been wrong. It was locked. What on earth was going on? I appeared to have been kidnapped for no reason at all. Narrowface and his anonymous friend couldn't have known I was carrying all that cash, and if it was the cash they were after, they would have just taken it and left me in the ditch. After the last 2 years and the way I'd behaved, I didn't have many friends left. To be accurate, I didn't have any friends at all. But then again, I didn't have any enemies. There might be quite a few people who disliked me or would not take my phone calls or who even might cross the street to avoid me if they saw me coming. But I couldn't think of anyone who would bother to go to the trouble these people had gone to. The effort of puzzling through these things was making my head ache, so I decided to do what I did best in difficult circumstances. I gazed at the ceiling and let my mind go blank. I've always believed in not worrying until you know what there is to worry about. Time passed. Then there was a sound at the door, and a man in a dark suit came in. He was carrying a silver tray with a glass of champagne on it, and he had newspapers clasped under his arm. He set the tray down on a small table beside the window.
Mr. Khan sends his apologies for keeping you waiting, sir. He wondered if you might enjoy a glass of champagne, sir, and a chance to read the day's papers. He will ask you to join him presently for a light lunch in the conservatory. I will come back and show you the way as soon as he is free.
I watched the man leave the room, my mouth open. I suppose I could have mounted an escape attempt, as the butler, or whatever he was, did not seem especially robust. But at that particular moment, neither was I. Any form of physical exertion seemed like a very bad idea, and trying to escape with no shoes did not appeal to me either. The door closed again and the key turned. I wandered across to the window and sipped the glass of champagne. It was chilled and delicious. Then I picked up the Times. There didn't seem any point in sulking, so I thought I would make myself comfortable while I could. I sat down in one of the armchairs and began to read the papers. A few minutes later, the door opened and the man in the dark suit appeared. In one hand, he held my shoes, which, despite being badly scuffed and down at heel, looked quite presentable again, having been buffed and polished to a deep shine. In the other hand, he held, on a hanger, my evening jacket, which had been brushed and pressed.
"I'm afraid we couldn't get some of the grass stains out, sir," he said, "but you can hardly see them now. If you would be kind enough to follow me downstairs, lunch will be ready in a moment."
I slipped on my jacket and my shoes and followed the man, servant or secretary, along the corridor, then down a much wider staircase than the one I had been dragged up, and into an entrance hall with a black and white marble floor and oak-panelled walls. Everywhere you looked, the touch of an interior decorator could be seen. Everything, even the older pieces of furniture, looked new, shining with polish, as if they had just been put there. The servant padded across the hall, then through a large drawing room. This was full of enormous armchairs and sofas, fitted with loose covers in a gold cloth with yellow corded piping. On the walls hung oils of 18th-century ladies and gentlemen, clutching children or muskets. A door had been opened up in the far wall of the drawing-room. This led into a vast glass conservatory. At first, all I could see was a profusion of tropical plants and orchids. The hiss of a spray could be heard, and I saw an automatic mister travelling along a rail above the beds of plants, showering them in a fine rain. There were two people in the conservatory. One I did not know. The other, stepping from behind a palm tree as I approached, was Narrowface. A marble table laid for two stood at one end of the room, and at the other end was a hot plate, on which various covered dishes had been set out. The tall, dark-skinned man was dressed in a white shirt and black trousers, and he was impressive-looking, in some way I could not at first define. His black hair was slicked back from his forehead with a lotion that gave off a sweet odour of almonds. He had a hawk nose and eyes that seemed very white and clear against his dark skin.
"Good afternoon, Mr. Gaunt," he greeted me. "My name is Mr. Khan. Please, come and sit down."
I looked at him carefully. This was a Pashtun. He might be from the Pakistan side of the border or from the other side, Afghanistan. Either way, he came from a difficult part of the world. I stepped forward and shook his hand when he offered it. It was rough and calloused. He waved me towards a chair.
"You must be hungry after your journey," he said. "We have some curries here. Some lamb, some biryanis. It is nothing much, but I hope it will suffice. I must apologize for the way in which you were brought here. Kevin!"
The smell of food was so delicious and my hunger suddenly so overpowering that I almost felt inclined to overlook the fact that I'd been run over by a large car and then kidnapped. Until I had eaten something, at least. But then Narrowface stepped forward and removed his sunglasses. The result was not an improvement. Small, weak eyes blinked at me as he said,
"Sorry we bumped into you like that, old man. I was trying to park the car and was a bit careless. Do hope you're feeling better."
He stretched out his hand. I suppose he expected that I would shake it and say, "No hard feelings," or something equally stupid. Instead, I stared at him until his hand dropped back to his side and his smile vanished. He was a mean, psychologically damaged-looking man. One day he would be a physically damaged-looking man if I had anything to do with it. Now was not the moment, though. So I just said, "Where's my money, Kevin, and my watch?"
"What is this?" demanded Mr. Khan. "Do you have some of his belongings, Kevin?"
"Just for safekeeping, Mr. Khan, sir," said Kevin. "You can't trust the banks these days, can you?"
He reached inside his jacket and took out my wallet and the white envelope containing the cash. As he did so, I saw he was wearing a shoulder holster under his jacket. He took my watch out of another pocket. The glass was cracked, and the watch had stopped.
"We were going to see if we could get the watch fixed for you, old man, but there wasn't time."
Kevin stepped forward, avoiding my eyes, and set my belongings carefully on the table. Then he stepped back and stood at ease.
"Kevin, I am so glad you took these things only for safekeeping," said Mr. Khan. "Because, you know, in my country, if someone takes things that do not belong to them, we cut off their hands."
The last words were spoken softly, but with an emphasis that made Kevin wince.
"Leave us alone now, while I give our guests some lunch," said Mr. Khan. "Do not go far away. I may need you later."
Kevin disappeared in the direction of the hallway. As far as I could tell, we were on our own now, unless there was someone else lurking in the undergrowth behind us in the conservatory. The sun had come out, and it was warm under the glass. Rich scents of unknown flowers and plants filled the air, mingled with the spicy smells of the food. Mr. Khan started spooning small amounts of delicious-looking saffron rice and spicy morsels of lamb onto a plate, which he handed to me. He poured me a glass of iced water from a copper jug.
"Is it to your liking?"
he asked, helping himself to a modest amount of rice and a spoonful of curry.
"Delicious. Thank you very much."
We both ate for a moment. Then Mr. Khan said,
"But I am forgetting my manners. You must be wondering why you were brought here in such a very extraordinary manner. I must apologize, by the way, for Kevin's carelessness. I hope you are not hurt.
I drank some water and said, I'm recovering. You seemed very keen to get me here. Mr. Khan smiled.
Of course, I will tell you why we went to such trouble in a moment. But first, do tell me a little bit about yourself, Mr. Gaunt.
There's nothing much to tell, I replied modestly.
You are an English gentleman? A member of English society? Is that why you were dressed in evening clothes at 8 o'clock in the morning?
This time I was the one who smiled, despite myself. This was the first time I'd been called a gentleman, and I enjoyed the irony. I wondered why Mr. Khan wanted to know about me, and whether there was any reason I should tell him anything. Besides, what was my profession these days? In the last 2 years, I had been a restaurateur for a while, then an ex-restaurateur. After that, I had slipped gracefully down the social and economic scale. I'd been a barman, a nightclub greeter, a bouncer, and a debt collector. You could take your pick. Few of my trades had lasted more than 8 to 12 weeks, and the most successful one since our restaurant had gone bust had been helping collect on unpaid or overdue loans. Even that, which was not exactly a gentleman's career, had come to an end. I had been too forceful in my methods with one or two of the clients I considered were having a laugh at my employer's expense. Well, no particular profession at present, I'm afraid, I said. My CV is broad rather than deep.
But you were in the army once, were you not?
Well, how did you know that? I asked in surprise.
An inspired guess on my part. And now you are a gentleman of means, a man of leisure?
I have plenty of leisure at the moment. I don't have a job.
And so last night you were at a dance, perhaps, attended by other members of society, or at a cocktail party. I have heard that the English are very fond of dances and cocktail parties.
As Mr. Khan spoke, he managed to invest each of these imagined jollities with capital letters. I laughed and then winced as my ribs flared with pain.
Oh, no such luck, I'm afraid.
I spent the evening at a club. Mr. Khan looked very respectful.
Ah, yes. An English club. And this morning you went for a walk to take exercise? The English are fond of taking exercise, I have heard.
Yes, I decided to go for a walk.
All the way from London? That is many miles.
Mr. Khan appeared to be intrigued by my eccentric behaviour, but I was becoming restless under his cross-examination. I'd waited long enough for an explanation of why I had been kidnapped, and I wouldn't have minded some compensation either. I decided to start asking a few questions of my own. You have a wonderful house, Mr. Khan, and a very good cook, and a very efficient staff. You must have worked hard to acquire such things around you. Mr. Khan smiled again. He smiled often, but the smiles never quite reached his eyes, with their brown irises surrounded by whites so clear they were almost blue. His eyes remained fixed on me all the time we spoke, scarcely blinking.
I have been fortunate, he said. I am a trader and a private banker, a rich man back at home, and not a poor man even in this wealthy country. I live here for a few weeks every year, and I like to keep the house up to a good standard for my friends and guests.
And where is home, Mr. Khan?
Where indeed, Mr. Gaunt? I travel so much I scarcely know where home is, or once was. A long time ago, it was a small village in the mountains of my homeland. Now, Dubai is my base. But I also have houses in Palermo, Beirut, and here. I am a fortunate fellow.
Mr. Khan was very good at not answering questions. I tried again.
You must do very good business being a banker, I said politely.
Yes, the families I work for support me, and I do my best to reward their good faith.
There was a silence while we both continued to eat. The exchange of career notes seemed to be over. Mr. Khan refilled my glass of water and offered me more lamb, which I refused. He must have pressed a bell push out of sight under the table, because the man in the dark suit appeared with a tray containing coffee cups. He set out the coffee things, cleared away the plates and dishes, and retreated with his tray.
"Are you a married man, may I ask?"
inquired Mr. Khan as we sipped our coffee. The conversation was becoming odder by the minute, yet I felt a weird sense of inevitability about it. "No, as a matter of fact, I'm not," I admitted.
"Have you ever considered it?" asked Mr. Khan.
This was such an odd remark in the circumstances that I think my mouth dropped open for a moment. I decided to keep talking. Maybe in the end I would find out what this was all about.
"Well, I might have done, but I have never really come close to the married state, not so far."
This was not quite accurate, but I felt that the present situation did not warrant too much candour.
"I myself," said Mr. Khan, taking a case from his pocket and offering me a large cigar, "have several wives. I have found marriage to be a rewarding state of affairs, and I thoroughly approve of it. You won't smoke. Do you mind if I do?"
He clipped the end from his cigar, then lit it and drew on it, puffing out a cloud of fragrant smoke. I rather wished I had accepted his offer, it smelled so good.
"God wants men to marry women," said Mr. Khan,
continuing his discourse.
"It is our natural state, after all."
He puffed some more on his cigar. Maybe now was the moment to ask why his hireling had knocked me down with a car and dragged me here, thereby causing me to lose a £6,000 bet. But before I could assemble the right words, Mr. Khan forestalled me.
"How old are you, Mr. Gaunt?"
"I'm 33, I replied. "Now, Mr. Khan, I really must ask you..." But he stopped me again, raising one hand.
"I think it is time you got married."
"Me? I'm afraid that's not on the cards, Mr. Khan. Perhaps you won't mind if I change the subject. Could you explain why I was brought here?" Again he cut me off, not impolitely, but firmly.
"But that is what we are talking about."
"I'm sorry?"
"That is why you were brought here. To get married."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.